Hi, in this video, we will talk about the thyroid synthesis inhibitors propylthiouracil and carbimazole or methimazole. Both these thyroid synthesis inhibitors belongs to the thioamide class. Carbimazole is converted in the body to the active compound methimazole. In some countries, carbimazole is approved, while in other places, methimazole is approved. So, we begin. If you recall one of my previous videos in which I have talked about thyroid hormone biosynthesis, you will remember the synthetic pathway that is being displayed on the screen. If we observe, thyroid synthesis inhibitors inhibits or blocks the enzyme thyroid peroxidase. So, these drugs, that is propylthiouracil and carbimazole, will inhibit the steps of oxidation, iodination and coupling. We can remember these steps as OIC, that is oxidation, iodination and coupling. Another important point, in addition to inhibiting thyroid peroxidase, propylthiouracil also inhibits the peripheral conversion of T4 to the more active hormone T3. Now, we will look at the basic differences between propylthiouracil and carbimazole. The first is potency. Propylthiouracil is less potent, carbimazole is more potent. Then is the plasma protein binding. This is high with propylthiouracil, less with carbimazole. Next is the half-life. Half-life is 1 to 2 hours with propylthiouracil. It is around 6 hours with carbimazole. Next is the duration of action. If the half-life is short, the duration of action will also be short and vice versa. So, the duration of action with propylthiouracil is 4 to 8 hours and with carbimazole, it is around 12 to 24 hours. Now, long duration of action is a distinct advantage of carbimazole because this has an effect on the dosing frequency. With propylthiouracil, the drug has to be given 2 to 4 times in a day, which is inconvenient for the patient. Whereas, with carbimazole, the drug needs to be given only once or sometimes 2 times in a day. Finally, the peripheral conversion of T4 to T3. This occurs only in the case of propylthiouracil and not carbimazole. This point makes propylthiouracil preferable in patients with thyroid storm, in which quick antithyroid action is required. And this blockade of peripheral conversion of T4 to the more active hormone T3 is beneficial in thyroid storm. So, how to remember these differences? Look at the drug names. Carbimazole has a shorter length of the name as compared to propylthiouracil, which has a longer name length. Although the name length of carbimazole is short as compared to propylthiouracil, but the half-life and duration of action is long. Just imagine, carbimazole, a short man, has a small organ, but it is more potent, more powerful, and longer acting as compared to the long man, propylthiouracil. Another observation. If we look at the orange bars on the left side of the slide, all the titles starting with the letter P, except the first one, that is potency, that is plasma protein binding and peripheral conversion, occurs with propylthiouracil, which also starts with the letter P. So P goes with P except for potency. Now let us look at the adverse effect. Both these drugs are generally well tolerated. Adverse effects occurs usually in around 3 to 12% of patients. The adverse effects mainly includes mild maculopapular rash. This is the most common adverse effect. It usually resolves spontaneously or may occur treatment with steroids, antihistaminics, etc. The second important adverse effect is agranulocytosis. This is a dangerous adverse effect which may be potentially fatal. It occurs rarely in around 0.1 to 0.5% of patients but develops so suddenly that periodic WBC counts are of little help because it might miss the sudden onset. Considering that this is a dangerous effect and it may occur suddenly, the patients should be clearly instructed to immediately stop the drug if they develop sore throat or fever, which are often the signs of underlying leukopenia. Immediate drug stoppage in such cases is also important because agranulocytosis is rapidly reversible if the drug is promptly discontinued. The third important effect is hepatotoxicity. Propylthiouracil in particular has been associated with an increased risk of severe hepatitis, and there is a black box warning for the risk of hepatitis and liver failure. So, in routine cases, propylthiouracil is not the first line treatment of thyrotoxicosis except in the following three situations. A. First trimester of pregnancy. Why? We will discuss in one of the subsequent slides. B. Thyroid storm. Propylthiouracil is beneficial in this condition because it inhibits the peripheral T4 to T3 conversion. And C. If the patient is allergic to carbimazole. The other rare adverse effects includes vasculitis, fever, joint pain, altered taste, GI intolerance and lymphadenopathy. Moving on to the indications or the uses of antithyroid drugs. These drugs are mainly used, number one, for the definitive treatment or Graves' disease. In this indication, carbimazole is preferred over propylthiouracil because of a single daily dose requirement resulting in a better patient compliance and a lower risk of severe hepatic toxicity. Second indication is that these drugs are used preoperatively for surgical preparation. The motive is to make the patient euthyroid before surgery and to decrease morbidity and mortality during surgery. Third indication is that these drugs are used along with radioactive iodine 131. The motive is to fasten the recovery while awaiting the effects of radiation and to prevent hyperthyroidism due to the release of stored hormone. Next, we move on to the usage of these drugs during pregnancy. Previously, we used to learn that propylthiouracil has a higher plasma protein binding, so it less crosses the placenta, so less of it reaches the fetus. Therefore, propylthiouracil should be considered as the preferred drug during pregnancy. But nowadays, there is a different concept. What we study nowadays is that propylthiouracil is preferred in the first trimester of pregnancy, whereas carbimazole is preferred in the second and the third trimesters of pregnancy. Let us look at the reason why. Propylthiouracil has a black box warning for severe hepatotoxicity. Hence, it is not the first line treatment of pregnancy except in the first trimester of pregnancy when carbimazole is to be avoided. And why is carbimazole to be avoided in the first trimester? Because carbimazole is teratogenic and rarely causes congenital malformations, that is aplasia cutis, choanal atresia, GI malformations, etc. Therefore, carbimazole is not preferred during organogenesis, that is when the organs develop, which is in the first trimester. This is the period when propylthiouracil is preferred. So, in summary, propylthiouracil is the preferred drug in first trimester of pregnancy and carbimazole is the preferred drug in the second and the third trimesters of pregnancy. And in the end, you just cannot afford to forget that radioactive iodine is clearly contraindicated during pregnancy. Thanks for watching. If you find this beneficial, please share. And if you have not subscribed yet, please do. Thank you.